again, everyone. We welcome you to our high school football game of the week preview show right here on WKYC.com. I'm Dave DiNatale alongside Tyler Carey as we get ready for week number two. We gave you three nominees as we do each Monday. We give you 48 hours to vote. Tyler, we had Brecksville Broadview Heights hosting Avon Lake as a nominee. We had a couple of powerhouses in all of Ohio football, Menor hosting St. Ignatius, and we had the Cinderella story from last year, No Row Nation, North Royalton hosting Highland. Those were your three nominees. Tyler Carey, if you please, where are we going this Friday?
Well, Dino, in a bit of an upset and kind of an overwhelming upset, it really wasn't close. We are headed to North Royalton, where the Bears will be hosting the Highland Hornets in week number two of the season, a suburban league matchup over at Serpentini Stadium that was a very close game last year with the Hornets winning 41-40 over the Bears. Again, not the typical matchup you would expect from the game of the week, especially when you had the opponents they were up against in the voting, but a very good matchup nonetheless. I'm very intrigued by what we're going to see Friday night.
Yeah, I had hoped that at some point we were going to see North Royalton again because, I mean, let's be honest. Last year, we think about all the games that we've done, and really arguably, if you look at the game of the week now in a year four, hard to stop the top that Olmsted Falls-North Royalton playoff game last year for the best game we've ever done. Maybe Menor, St. Edward probably is.
Pretty good Avon Lake game last year, too.
Yeah. But that one, just because of the sheer surprise, the I can't believe this is happening again type of effect. That's North Royalton, and, you know, they're not going to take anybody by surprise. I think we remember talking about that in the playoffs last year. You know, when you go on the road, you beat Amherst. You go on the road and you beat Olmsted Falls. I mean, that, you know, those are market wins, and they had struggled all year long, and it didn't look like they were ever going to get off the schneid, but the fact that they were able to get them in the playoffs because of COVID rules, not only did they get those playoff victories, but I think they set the tone for what the program can be going forward.
No, I would agree 100%, and for those who don't remember, before they got into the playoffs, they started 0-6.
Yeah.
Before those upset wins over Steele and Olmsted Falls. Now, they end up finishing the season 2-8 because they had a blowout playoff loss to Avon Lake. Again, really no shame in that. Avon Lake does that to a lot of teams in Division II. And then they played kind of a bonus game against Berea Mid-Park.
So that's right.
They finished 2-8. The record was a little bit deceptive. Now, at the end of the day, you are what your record says you are. But as I mentioned, very close loss to Highland. They played Stowe very tough, only lost by a touchdown. Berea Mid-Park, they played them close. Even Brecksville Broadview Heights, it was a pretty tough game. So the talent was always there. Maybe they just weren't ready to bust through yet, and then they finally had their moment in the postseason. Michael Piazza, not the catcher, doing very well for him, a quarterback. Jacob Lipchak leading that defense. They're both back this year. And now they come off. They get a very nice win over Westlake. Not a very formidable opponent, but still always good to start 1-0.
That's it.
And now they get a chance to really, I think, make their mark on this season. If they can go and start 2-0 against what has always been a very good Highland team, then I think you get people start thinking, all right, maybe they finally arrive. Maybe they can get that first non-COVID-aided playoff appearance since 2012.
Yeah, and I mean, Highland's always a tough opponent. Coach Gibbons does a great job down there in Medina County with that team. They get to travel north now and play, as you said, at Serpentini Stadium. I'm excited. You know, we've seen Highland a couple of times on the game of the week, and I can remember the loss against Wadsworth, I think, in a game we did against them. Lost against Brunswick, I think, in a game we did with them. But I'm excited to see the Hornets because I think when they put it together, they're a tough out for anybody.
They're always fun to watch, especially with that running offense you see, and they're always competitive in Division II, where maybe they're not gonna make a run to the state finals, but they're usually there and they're usually gonna give some of the more formidable teams some fits where they know they can't overlook them. They did win their first game. They beat Berea Mid-Park, a team we brought up earlier.
Good win.
Aaron Phillips, three rushing touchdowns in that game, including a 63-yarder.
Wow.
In what was kind of a blowout victory against a very solid Titans team. And you know that they know how good North Royalton is. We mentioned that Noro's kind of going to have that target on their back after catching people by surprise last year. And with the Hornets only winning by 1 point last season, having to go on the road this time, they can't take him for granted.
Before we get to the games this weekend and Tyler's top five, going to be hard for any game this year to top what we had last Friday night down in Cuyahoga Falls. Back and forth matchup as we thought it was going to be between Walsh Jesuit and Benedictine. And boy, it all came down to extra points. One team made their extra point. One team had theirs blocked. But those two teams about as evenly matched as you can be. And I think the final score, that 35-34 game, reflected that.
And how ironic. Christian Cora only gets a chance to win it again after his first attempt for Benedictine was blocked.
Yep.
His own team commits a false start. Dead ball. Go back 5 yards, and he nails it. A fantastic win for the Bengals, a devastating loss for the Warriors, because you know after losing to Benedictine in the playoffs last year, they were thinking about that all offseason. You get them week one. They missed so many opportunities to really put that game away. Benedictine just kind of hung around. It ends up kind of going back and forth, as you said, in the fourth quarter. C.J. Yarbrough, what a game for
him. He was brilliant.
Four touchdowns.
He was brilliant.
Showing that that experience he got last year coming in, kind of as an inexperienced young starter, is really going to pay dividends for him and the Bengals going forward. Like you said, fantastic game. Going to be tough to top that, but I'm looking forward to seeing if teams can try.
Let's you know, I mean, North Royalton Highland, the bar is set pretty high, and we'll see if you can match it. So that's our game of the week. Again, the Hornets and the Bears from Serpentini Stadium on Friday night. Dennis Maniloff will join me for the play-by-play starting at 6:50. What else are you going to be watching Friday night as far as games to keep an eye on? In addition to obviously our other nominated games, Menor and St. Ignatius certainly stand out. What other games stand out to you Friday night?
Well, we'll get to some of the other games involving the top five. You already mentioned Menor and St. Ignatius.
Yeah.
As we mentioned, these two teams both hail from the Suburban League, one of the deepest leagues, I think, in all of Northeast Ohio. Just some involving teams from this area. Berea Mid-Park is going to be playing Nordonia, trying to get off that tough loss to Highland in week one. Avon Lake and Brecksville Broadview Heights, as we mentioned, one of our other nominees. Hudson going to play Euclid. Hudson got a very nice one over Solon in week one, and Euclid really beaten up by Aurora in that first
game. I'm not surprised that they lost to Aurora. I'm surprised they gave up that many points.
63-21.
That didn't see that one coming to that extreme.
I think it shows us just how good Aurora is this year. Speaking of the Green Men, they're going to be headed to Akron to play St. Vincent, St. Mary.
That's a delicious game. Wow.
Yeah, that doesn't get any easier for Bob Mahalik's crew, but they're going to be up to the task.
Oh, and that'll be fun.
Wadsworth, who you mentioned earlier, they're headed down to Wayne County. They're playing Worcester, always a very good team.
Absolutely.
So some very good Suburban League games this week, and we'll have our eye on most of them on Friday night.
All right. That leads us, as we do here every week on the Game of the Week preview, to look at Tyler's top five, the top five teams in Northeast Ohio, as voted by Tyler Carey. But as we look at it, I'm curious to see, you know, if the impact of some of those week one games in your thought process here for this week.
Well, I will say, Dino, for now, the top five is the same as it was last week. Now, because they all the teams won, and I kind of felt weird moving any of them down or up. However, as I read through some of the matchups they'll have this Friday, that could change.
Yes.
That could very well change as we go through into week three. But let's take a look. If you remember from last week, Hoban still number five. They won 38-0 over Bishop Sycamore, that academy team down in Columbus.
Nice statement for them to
definitely
start out.
Definitely is, especially after losing a lot of starters last year. For the newer guys, Lamar Sperling, 135 yards, 3 touchdowns on the ground. Brian Cushing had a solid game. I'll get to that in a second. But Lamar Sperling had 135 yards on the ground, 3 scores for Hoban, leading the victory. Now this week, they are staying home in Akron. They're playing a team called Bergen Catholic out of New Jersey.
Yes. Okay.
17-time New Jersey state champions.
Wow.
And yes, it is the alma mater of players like Brian Cushing, former Houston Texans star. That's where I got that mixed up
there.
But yeah, that's going to be a test for Hoban.
Yeah.
And they,
yeah.
they usually meet the challenge, but we'll see how they can do this week.
And this is what happens. You know, St. Ignatius will tell you, St. Edward will tell you, when the reputation rises, you get not only the best in Ohio, but you get the best from teams outside of the state. And so that'll be fun to see how the Knights stack up against a powerhouse from another state. That'll be fun to see.
Absolutely. Okay, number four, Dino, a team that we've all said is loaded this year, Stoneman Roll Falls Bulldogs, a 55-0 victory over the lowly Cuyahoga Falls Tigers. Just to take you through what happened, this was a 48-0 game at halftime.
Oh, boy.
They pulled the starters before halftime. The Bulldogs in this game had a pick-six touchdown, two fumble returns for touchdowns, a block punt for a touchdown, and, oh, by the way, Xavier Preston, two rushing touchdowns.
So you're selling multiple touchdowns on offense, defense, and special teams.
Yes, the jack-of-all-trades this team was.
Oh, they'll love that. I mean, the coaching staff, those films at least were fun on Saturday morning to watch because each, you know, facet of the team got a chance to kind of have a moment. But yeah, I'm with you. I think all year long, I think we've been gearing up to see Stowe as one of the elite teams in Northeast Ohio. And, you know, certainly indicative of that is what we saw last Friday.
And they'll head to Barberton this week. So a little bit more of a test, but I got to think they're still going to be the favorites in that one. Number three, same, the Battling Bees of Medina after a 31-14 win over a pretty good Warren G. Harding team that went to the round of 16 last year. Now, if this doesn't tell you just how important Drew Aller is to this bunch, Medina had 281 yards of total offense. Aller had 235 of them combined rushing and passing, two touchdowns through the air as they get the opening victory. So a solid win for Medina, but this week it really gets interesting. They play a team that just missed my top five, the Avon Eagles.
I would think Avon, you know, this is kind of a battle for a top five. Avon, to go into Brunswick and beat the Blue Devils, not surprised. To completely dominate Brunswick the way they did, especially with their defense, just shutting out and shutting down the Blue Devils, that was surprising and that was impressive. And, you know, everybody was concerned offensively, you know, Pappas is gone. How are the Eagles going to react to that? Mike Elder reloads, and I think they sent a message to everybody that, you know, we're still to be counted among the elite of Northeast Ohio. And if they can, again, go on the road, head down I-71, get another victory over a Medina County juggernaut in Medina, that would prove it.
I was talking to Adam Kenyon, one of our tech guys here at Channel 3, and he has ties to Medina. Yeah. Also knows some people down in Brunswick. Those Blue Devil fans, he said, thought they were going to win by about two touchdowns.
Yeah. They thought coming off of a great year that they had last year, and we saw them a couple of times talking about Brunswick, they really thought that they could physically beat Avon, and it was the other way around. And I think that was as shocking as everything else. But, you know, Coach Elder had his team ready to go. That said, I would imagine the Blue Devils will bounce back from that.
Statement for the Eagles. They are not going away, that's for sure. Number two, another Eagles team, St. Edward. They got a nice 33-10 win over Toledo Central Catholic, always a formidable foe.
It's a good team. That's a good team. I know that's not Division I, but that's a good team that they beat.
Multi-time state champions, always with a lot of Division I prospects.
Always the thorn to the side of teams in Northeast Ohio in the playoffs.
No kidding. This game was 3-3 at halftime before St. Edward just kind of pulled away. Daniel Inovich on the ground, three touchdowns in this game for St. Edward. They will head back to Lakewood this week. They're going to play Rock Creek Christian Academy out of Maryland. They're kind of just starting their football program, but their coach, Andre Cates, is just coming from another Christian Academy program in Maryland that has been known to produce a lot of Division I prospects. So I don't know if Rock Creek is going to be as formidable this year, but they're definitely building something there. It'll be an interesting test for St. Edward.
Yeah, see what they can do, home game for them, and kind of get themselves going, because they're going to have Mentor coming up. They're going to have St. Ignatius coming up here in the next couple weeks. So get the kinks out. I would assume they would be a team that they can handle, but You know, they're not going to – yeah, they will not look ahead of, of this week's opponent, and it hopefully would set themselves up to feel good about themselves going into some of those tough games early season.
One more note on St. Edward that I want to mention. One of their top players this year was supposed to be Trey Bixby, the defensive end, four-star player, committed to Minnesota. He has left the team. He has decided to play his senior season at Eden Prairie High School in Minnesota, where he has a lot of family and relatives there. It makes sense, but it is a bit of a significant loss for St. Edward.
Yeah, yeah.
Unfortunate, but knowing Tom Lombardo, the talent he brings in there, I think they'll be fine.
So
good luck to you, Trey. Hate to see you go, but always important to see family whenever you can.
Be with family. Represent, though. Do well up there.
Absolutely. All right, the number one team, as mentioned last week, they remain there, and boy, did they make a statement. The Menor Cardinals. 49-7 victory on the road against Canton McKinley. Of course, the Bulldogs have been kind of reeling from a tough offseason. We knew that Menor was going to have to replace some players, normally Ian Kipp at quarterback. Well, Jacob Snow came in there and looked like he had been doing it for years. Four touchdown passes in the game. Menor gets more than 500 yards of total offense in the blowout win. And as we previously brought up, they're going to be taking on St. Ignatius in week two. St. Ignatius has kind of been a little bit treading water the last couple of years, and they lost their opening game. So we'll see if they can finally make a statement and get a big win of their own against, as always, a formidable Menor team.
Yeah.
It's going to be an important game this weekend.
I always think whoever wins that Menor, because they usually play in week two or week three, whoever wins that game, it sets the tone. It really does,
absolutely,
I think, for those teams to get through. You know, are we going to have a challenging regular season, or can we, you know, get ourselves solidified before October, November? So I'll be curious. You know, Menor's kind of had the better of this matchup of the last year or two. So can St. Ignatius go on the road? It's always a tough environment at Osborne Stadium. But St. Ignatius does also travel well with their fans. So I'll be curious to see who comes out of this one, you know, with the upper hand.
And look, this game does not have the playoff implications that it used to, only because
the region's expanded.
Every team in the region except one is going to make the playoffs this year. We don't have to give our thoughts on that. But when you talk about seeding, and yes, when you talk about that momentum going into the postseason and through the rest of the regular season, it is an important game, and you know that both these coaches aren't going to take it for granted. They want to win this battle.
Yeah, and for Menor, again, you know, you get St. Ignatius and St. Edward in back-to-back weeks. So this is a big, you know, to start a season with McKinley, St. Ignatius, and St. Edward. I mean,
they've always taken all comers.
They do, and that's what makes Menor a Menor, and St. Ignatius will be ready as well. So we'll keep an eye on all those games as we go Friday night. But again, our game of the week for week two, our WKYC.com high school football game of the week, will take us to Serpentini Stadium. The North Royalton Bears will play host to the Highland Hornets. Again, we'll greet you at 6:50 for the play-by-play, the audio play-by-play, and we'll have scores throughout the night from some of the other games going on across the area. So we are off and running and ready for an exciting week here this weekend.
I'm excited, Dino. I think it's going to be a really close game, and it could be really important, as we mentioned, for seeding and momentum down the road. Can NoRo assert themselves as a real, true contender in this league? We'll have to wait and see. I'm excited.
Or can Highland, the team that won the very first WKYC game of the week, can they pick up a victory on Friday on the road?
No pressure.
We'll find out. We'll see you Friday night from North Royalton for our WKYC.com high school football game of the week. For Tyler Carey, I'm Dave DiNatale. Thanks so much for watching right here on WKYC.com.